So this is the question from March 2020 exam, and it's a question, section B type question. So we'll start from section B type question first. And first of all, your strategy is to just check out the requirement in the exam. We'll also practice a few questions on the Excel and Word platform too. Not today, in any other day. So let's just see the requirement. First of all, let's identify what are the topics that has been asked in the question. So you can also find out it from here. Pedro require advice on the reason he has to pay IHT. So first one is the task related to IHT. And the second one task is related with the income tax issue, that is the letting of furnished holiday letting. So one is the IHT, second one is the property income. This is IHT, this is property income. And third one is the pension scheme. This is again the income tax topic. Now remember that pension is one of the important topics. You can just mark for your exam that pension is my first important topic for the upcoming exam. Pension contribution, the amount of relief, the additional charge, so and so on. Now let's talk about the detailed requirement. First one says that explain. So it's a theory, just theory. The inheritance tax implication of the gift of cottage to Pedro at the time the gift was made and as a result of death. So this is about IHT and it's maybe lifetime gift. The detail is in the question. So it's a lifetime gift. Second thing is, again, explain by reference to the relevant conditions why the holiday cottage will qualify as furnished holiday letting for the first 12 months of letting. So this is the FHL conditions are being asked. If you know the conditions, then it's straight 5 marks. So both part are quite reasonable in terms of you can easily answer if you know the rules regarding this. Third one is a very complex calculation. And this is pertaining to calculate the reduction in income tax liability as a result of some pension contribution in personal pension scheme. You should know that there are two types of scheme. One is called the personal pension scheme and that is called the occupational pension scheme. And there are some differences in personal pension scheme and occupational pension scheme. Your answer should include an explanation of the amount of personal allowance available to Pedro in this case. And this is worth 10 marks. And this particular type of question related to pension is frequently being examined in the past papers. You can check one of the question in kit, revision kit, Jessica. There is also a pension question. So get ready for that. So let's just identify the information and one by one we will solve this. Now it's not necessary in the real exam that you should go for the requirement in sequence. So you can solve C part first, B part first, A part first. But in section A, question number one, it is always advisable to go straight, to go with the sequence, but not in section B or question number two, three, or four. Any sequence is allowed. Now let's talk about the information. So what is the position of Pedro? Pedro was given a holiday cottage in the UK by his aunt Marina on 4th March 2011. Now, the date of gift is very important, because from the date of gift, if it is a PET or if it's a CLT, we know that PET is exempt at the time of transfer, not taxable, but CLT is taxable. And this is a PET because it has been given by the aunt Marina. And within 7 year rules, we should know that if she die within 7 years, so you have to pay tax. So paid inheritance tax in respect of the gift of the holiday cottage following Marina's death on 8 June 2021. Now, there is a 7 years rule. If you follow that 7 years rule, so the date of gift is 12/2011, and the date of death is 2021. So it's more than 7 years. If it is more than 7 years, then why it's taxable? It means there is something additional in this question. It's not a normal, typical question. So let's see. Inherited a portfolio of UK furnished properties valued at 6,70,000 on Marina's death. Now, gift of the holiday cottage in the UK by Marina. Marina and Pedro agreed that she could stay in the house for 2 months each year, rent free, which she did every year until her death. Now, this is a concept called gift with reservation. As it's a gift with reservation, that's why it is taxable, even if the death is after 7 years. Now, this is the information about IHT. It's a gift with reservation. A gift was given by his aunt on 11/2011, and after a few years, there is a death. So what is the consequences? What is the rule? Explain the inheritance tax implication of the gift at the time the gift was made and as a result of Marina's death. So we have to tell the examiner, what is the consequences at the time of gift and what are the consequences at the time of death? So if you know the rules regarding gift with reservation, so first of all, you have to explain what is this, and then you have to tell the complete solution. Now, let me just discuss. So it's requirement one. The gift is classified as gift with reservation. Why? You have to explain. So you have to give the explanation why it's a gift for with reservation. Because Marina is still using even after transfer of asset without rent free. So this is the definition or justification of gift with reservation. So at the time of transfer, it's a PET and so no tax at that time. As she used it till her death, it means now there are concept that whether the house was occupied till the death or whether it was reservation was lifted or not. So I have to mention the point, as she used it till her death, it means the reservation was not lifted. Reservation was not lifted. Now, what is the consequence? Now, HMRC will charge tax on hire of one potentially exempt transfer if it's taxable. And considering part of death state, whichever is higher. Now, in our case, as the death is after 7 years, so it means that as the death is after 7 years, so liability is nil in terms of PET, but that will be part of death state, and as a result, after considering the NRB on death, what is the gift value? The gift value was 6,70,000. The taxable amount would be 6,70,000. This is the value minus the NRB. Now, this is the enough explanation in order to get your relevant 5 marks. Because the question says that explain that at the time of transfer, what is the treatment? And as a result of death, and as it has been mentioned that the Marina was using this till her death, so the point of gift with reservation is quite useful. So in order to get full marks, you have to tell the examiner each and everything in the requirement. If you miss any single point, you will miss the marks. So this is the explanation. There is no calculation involved, simply explanation. And in the CB exam, it's to be solved on the word processing document. If the question is about theory, 100%, or even some minor calculation is needed, always use the word document. And if there is 100% calculation based part of the question, then always use the Excel. Because Excel is good for calculation. And if there is any minor explanation, you can show this in the word processing document with reference of Excel working. Now let's move to the other part. Now, gift with reservation is again an important topic. It's repetitively being asked in the past papers. So you should focus on the treatment, that what is the exact treatment of gift with reservation. Now let's talk about the next one, and let's move to the data first. Property income. An important thing is that just check that how I'm reading the requirement, how I'm identifying the requirement, and then how I'm connecting with the data in the question, and then follow the answer. Because if you correctly identify the requirement and read the data properly, then the chance of getting high marks is quite good. Otherwise you will lose some marks. So the cottage, which is a fully furnished one, has been available for rental on a commercial basis since 1st July 2021 and have a 70% occupancy rate for the first year of letting. No tenants will have stayed in the cottage for more than 14 days during the first year of letting. The rental income is 14,500 tax year 2022. In the tax year 21-22, Pedro will also receive net rental income of 32,000 from the unfurnished property. Now, this is the information, some rent information and some utilization information. Now, the requirement says that an explanation of why this letting is constituted as a FHL. So simply you need to understand that, simply you have to explain that what is an FHL. So if you know that from the from your theory, that what is a furnished holiday letting business is. So in if you revise your furnished holiday letting, so there is a criteria called that in order to classify at furnished holiday letting, following condition must be satisfied. In order to classify property as FHL, following conditions must be satisfied. What are those conditions? So one condition is about the availability of property, which is availability criteria. And second is actual letting. And third is about long-term occupation. So if you know the details of these three items, you can get the 5 marks. Now, what is the availability criteria? What it means, availability? So in order to classify as a FHL, the property must be available for at least 210 days. The property must be available for at least 210 days. And 210 days, let's see, the property was given on rent on 1st July 2021. So it's from July, August, September, October, November, December, Jan, Feb, March. It's approximately 9 months. So that means the availability is more than 6 months, more than 7 months. So you can say that the property must be available for at least 210 days. And in the above question, the criteria is satisfied. So availability criteria is available here. Now, second thing is that the actual letting. One is the availability, other is the utilization. Now, what is the letting criteria? The property must be let out for at least 105 days. From the above situation, it is quite understood that the property was given for at least 105 days. The third is long-term occupation. And what is the definition of long-term occupation? A property is given for straight 31 days to any given customer, then it is called a long-term occupation. So you will write that as no one use this for more than 14 days, it means cumulative period is less than 155 days is less than 155 days. So it's not a long-term occupation. It should not be part of long-term occupation. Now, these are the 3 points of FHL. Once you have written those 3 points, now from the above conditions or from the above criterias, from the above conditions, the property is a furnished holiday, FHL furnished holiday. Another thing is that it must be in UK, it must be given as a furnished property. All has been given in the question. So main thing, in order to get marks, you have to write 3 things: availability criteria, letting criteria, and you have to check that whether it's a part of long-term occupation or not. So this is a straight 5 marks, nothing complicated. Now let's talk about the calculation side. Third one. First, see about income tax data. So we have been given some income tax information. First one is the rental information. This is the rental information. This is the rental information. This is the rental information. And then we have some employment information. Pedro has been employed by L Limited since 6th April. 6th April means throughout the tax year. He has received a gross salary of 75,000 for the whole year. He also contributed, the company, the employer, 8,000 in each of the tax year to its occupational scheme. So it means one scheme is occupational. What about personal pension scheme? There is some personal pension scheme is also there. Pedro has never been a member of pension scheme prior to taking up employment with L Limited. Pedro wishes to start contributing to a personal pension scheme in the tax year 21-22. Pedro intends to make his first contribution into a new scheme of 85,000 gross on 31st March 2022 in the tax year 21-22. The annual allowance available to Pedro was not restricted in any previous tax year. Pedro's income tax liability for the tax year 2022 before considering this contribution was, income tax liability was 41,260. This is the information. Mainly it's about the occupational contribution and the personal pension. Now, what is the question? Question says that calculate the reduction in income tax liability. So what is the income tax liability? It's 41,260. So we have to check that if there is a contribution of 85,000 into a PPC, will there be any reduction in tax liability? So as a result of making the planned contribution of 85,000 to PPC, your answer should include an explanation of the personal allowance calculation and so on. Now let's do some calculation here. This type of the question should be solved on Excel because the question is based on calculation. So it's income tax question partly income tax, partly pension liability. First of all, reduction in income tax liability. So first of all, let's identify the income tax first. Now see here, we have employment income. And how much is the employment income? How much is the employment income? The employment income is 75,000. 75,000 is an employment income. So we have 75,000 of employment income. How much is the property income? So we have two property income. One is the cottage, 14,500. Other is the unfurnished property, 32,000. So we have to combine it together, 14,500 plus 32,000. So it's 46,500. This is the total income, 121,500. This is total income. This is total income. Now we know that from the total income, we have to deduct the personal allowances. Now, as we know that if the income exceeds from 1 lakh, which income? The ANI. If ANI exceeds 100,000, what is the rule? The PA will be reduced by half of the excess value. But we also know that if there is any personal pension contribution, then that personal pension contribution reduces the net income. So what we have to do? What we have to do? We have to consider the net income first. So let's talk about the net income first. So this is the working personal allowance discussion. The net income is as net income is 1,20,500 minus PPC. This is PPC. Is how much? Is 36,500. This is ANI, adjusted net income. As adjusted net income is less than 100,000, is 36,500. So personal allowances available full personal allowances available, that is 12,500. So it means that here you can offset 12,500 and your taxable income is 1,21,500 minus 12,500, 1,09,000. Now this is one of the working. Now another thing, we know that another working, this is working number one. This is working number two. we have to check that we have to compare gross pension contribution with the amount of annual allowance available. If contribution exceed the annual allowance, there would be a annual allowance charge. So first of all, we have to see what is the annual allowance, availability of annual allowance. Then we have to see the availability of threshold as well. So let's talk about annual allowance charge. So let's talk about annual allowance charge. As I told earlier, it's a complex calculation. So total contribution, one is the occupational. What was the occupational contribution? 8,000. Personal contribution. Personal contribution was planned as 85,000. So total contribution is 93,000. Now, we have to check the annual allowance available. We have to deduct the annual allowance available. Now, I need to work out another thing. For annual allowance, I need to work out something, some working. So let's refer it to working number 3. Now another working number 3, and that is the availability of annual allowance. Annual allowance 2021. Now there is rule called that first of all you have to assess that what is the threshold income. You have to see the threshold income. So in order to calculate threshold income, what is the definition of threshold income? Net income. And net income was 1,21,500. And we have to deduct the PPC, 85,000. So we get threshold income 36,500. This is 36,500. So as threshold income is less than 200,000, so full annual allowance is available. So it means in 2021, we have how much annual allowance is available? We have 40,000 annual allowance available. So you can write here 40,000 annual allowance. And this is 2021-2022. Now, another thing is that we can also deduct the annual allowance of the previous year, last 3 years. So it has been mentioned in the question that the pension scheme was started in 2021. So in the previous year, we have also some pension contribution. So let's see how much annual allowance was unused annual allowance. So you can write a note, unused annual allowance. The contribution in 2021 was 8,000. So unused contribution, unused allowance was 40,000 minus 8,000 contribution. So it's 32,000. So the available unused allowance is 2021 is 32,000. Now, if your contribution is greater than the available annual allowance, there is annual allowance charge. An annual allowance charge is an income. So you have to allow tax, you have to put tax on this annual allowance charge. So there is a 21,000 annual allowance charge. And we have to show this annual allowance charge. We have to put tax on this in the main performer. Here, we'll calculate tax on annual allowance charge. So this is the working. Now we have income tax. Now we have annual allowance charge. So what we have to do? We have to calculate the income tax liability. But before moving with income tax liability, we have to do one thing extra. And what is that? We should know that if there is personal contribution, there is a band extension, and your basic band will extend from 37,500 at the amount of personal pension contribution or the amount of relief available. The amount of relief is same as pension contribution is in this example. We don't need to check that. So the band will extend to 1,22,500. This is the first band. Now my taxable income is 109. So it falls within the first band. But if I add the annual charge, 21,000, it will cross the first band and it will fall into the second band. So we know that the annual allowance charge is considered as non-saving income and is also considered as last slice of income. So we have to consider the annual allowance charge at the end of non-saving income, saving income, and dividend income. Now let's calculate the income tax liability. I have to put here income tax liability. So first of all, the taxable income, the non-saving taxable income, the normal non-taxable income. So it's non-saving income 109,000. It's in the first band after extension. So it's 21,800. Now the first band was closed at 1,22,500. So 1,22,500. So this is AA charge. And how much AA charge falls in the first band? It's 13,500. Can put a rate of 20% on this, 2,700. An additional charge is in the second band. So the remaining additional charge of AA is 7,500. It's 7,500 and the rate is now double. That is the 40% because it is in the second band. So it's 3,000. Combine all the income. You can see income tax liability is 27,500. This is revised income tax liability. This is revised income tax liability. Now, what was the question? The question was identify the reduction in income tax liability as a result of contribution, and also explain the personal allowance. I have already explained the personal allowance calculation. Now I have to find out the reduction in income tax liability. So above income tax liability is 41,260. Now let's calculate the reduction in income tax liability. There is a reduction in tax liability of, how much is the reduction? 41,260 minus 27,500. There is a reduction of 1,370. In this way, I have addressed the requirement correctly. I have also explained the personal allowance consequences as well as the reduction in income tax liability. So this is the 10 marks calculation, almost 10 marks is for calculation, just for explanation, few marks for the explanation, although it's mainly a calculation based question. So in the CB exam, prefer to work out all this in Excel, all the working separately. And I told you in the start of this lecture that pension contribution, especially the personal pension contribution, is one of the most examinable topics. So you just need to have good calculation skills of pension contribution, especially the reduction in annual allowance, the double A charge, the unused annual allowance brought forward, the relevant earning definition calculation. So you need to, the extension of band, each and everything. So this is our first question. Again, let's just see the requirement of the question, what has been asked, because it's a different type of question. So you can see the requirement is having less information. Just mention that this part is 4 marks, this part is 15 marks, this part is 6 marks. So we have to see in the question, because the requirement is also in the question A, B and C. So the A part says that, this part says that related to sale of shares, calculate capital gain tax liability. So it's a part question based on CGT in respect of the proposed sale of business, considering all the relief available. Now, relief, CGT relief, very, very important topic. Any relief can be asked. So for this exam, keep in mind PRR, LR and BADR, because there are some changes. So keep in mind these especially. Now few instructions we'll consider later it on. First one is the CGT. The second one is the R&D. The second one is about R&D. It's a corporation question. It's about the intangible asset, the second part. It's about the VAT implication. Second one part is about these three issues. And the last one is about overseas. It's about permanent establishment. Again, note one thing, that for any exam, this R&D, especially SME, for a small and medium enterprise, this is a very important topic. Should know the rules that which kind of expenditure is available against R&D. The 130% excess expenditure is allowed against R&D, that is 230 in total. So what are the amount that is available for exemption for allowance or not? Similarly, there is a rule called large company rule. So now let's see the question in detail. One by one. Your manager has received a letter from Meeta, the owner and managing director of Porth Limited, a client of your firm's. Extraction from that letter together with extraction from an email are given below. Extract. First of all, this is an extract. Number one, sale of 4,000 ordinary shares in Porth Limited. On 1st May 2020, I am going to sell 4,000 shares in Porth Limited to my brother. So this is a case of disposal. I note from the work you have already done that the current market value is 2,60,000. However, because I am keen to get N involved, I have agreed a price of 200,000. Now, if you recall the rules from CGT, so there is a concept called gift relief. And if you are selling shares undervalued, then it might cover under gift relief. So you have to consider whether there is any kind of gift relief available or not. What are the conditions of gift relief? We will get gift relief or not. If conditions are satisfied, then you will talk about gift relief. If not, then we will consider any other type of relief which is available on that. So let's see further what additional information is available. So this is sale at undervalue. This is undervalued sale. And undervalued sale is to be considered against gift relief. NED, who is a UK resident, will sign the claim for capital gain tax relief in respect of the sale. So first one is the disposal of 4,000 shares. What is the cost of 4,000 shares? So we have to identify how I have obtained this 4,000 shares. So now the details. Joint venture with Q Limited. So on 1st April 2022, I shall incorporate a new company, Q Limited. On that day, Q Limited will register for VAT and begin to trade. It will develop a range of product over the next few years. And the planned ownership of the ordinary share capital of Q Limited is as follows. Porth Limited is having 60% shares. Mr. B or Mr. B's company, 30% shares. C Limited, 10% shares. P Limited, B Limited and CX Limited are our UK resident companies. And Mr. B is also resident in UK. So we have incorporated a new company and the shareholding has been given. I have calculated Q Limited's budgeted tax adjusted trading loss for the year ended March to be 44,000. Now, my first question was related with, can I solve it now? Capital gain tax liability against the sale of this. Meeta is resident in UK. You should assume that she will be a higher rate taxpayer and the CGT annual exemption will not be available to her. So this is important that it's a higher rate payer. You have to calculate considering higher rate payer and no CGT is available. Now, one thing is missing. I know what is the value of shares, what is the agreed price, what are the numbers, but I have no information from where I get this. So I have to see some additional information. And there is some additional information about this one, additional information. I have the 4,000 shares of Porth Limited. So let's see from where I get this 4,000 shares. So there is some information, Porth Limited. Meta owns the whole of the ordinary share capital of Porth Limited, which is an unquoted company. It was a unquoted trading company. Meta began trading as an unincorporated business on 1st June. On 1st April, when the assets of her business were worth 1,20,000, she incorporated her business by selling all of the assets to Porth Limited in exchange for 10,000 ordinary shares. Now, this is a concept which is called incorporation relief under CGT. It means there are some topics that are being mixed. One is the sale of 4,000 shares, but you have obtained those shares as a result of an incorporation of a new company. That is been created from an unincorporated business to a company. The sale resulted in total chargeable gain of 37,500, all of which were relieved by incorporation relief. Means complete gain was utilized as incorporation relief. Now, here I have to do some working. Just for my reference, that the market value was 1,20,000. The gain was 37,400. So it means that the base cost is 1,20,000 minus 37,400. This is the base cost. We have to identify the base cost of the shares. So the base cost of the shares is 82,600. And this is the base cost of 10,000 ordinary shares. Now, from this 10,000 ordinary shares, now I have to relate this with the first part, that I have sold 4,000 ordinary shares out of 10,000. So I have to allocate the base cost with the gift calculation. Now let's identify the first part, sale of 4,000 ordinary shares. So here is sale of 4,000 ordinary shares. Now, let's talk about the capital gain tax liability. Let's identify capital gain tax liability. First of all, there is a 4,000 disposal of shares and the price that has been charged is market value, 2,60,000. So proceed is at market value, 2,60,000. Now I have to deduct the cost. So cost is, so there is the working. Above working, this is the working. This is the relevant working. This is the base cost, 82,600. Now let's allocate 82,600, 4,000 shares out of 10,000. So this is the allocation of cost, and which is 33,040. And as a result, the gain before relief is 226,960. Gain before relief. Now it was mentioned in the question that a gift relief is available. Now, how much is the gift relief? Very complicated part, because in just one part there is an incorporation relief as well as there is any gift relief. So how you can identify that how much is the gain which is chargeable? Because it's a sale at undervalue. The sale took place at 200,000. So that means the market price is 260. The market price is 260 and the selling price is 200,000. So it means the amount of chargeable gain. Now you can calculate chargeable gain as the excess of sale proceed minus cost. This is the chargeable gain, which is 166,960. This is the chargeable gain. Now total gain without relief is 226,960. And chargeable gain is 166,960, because this is sale at undervalue. So this is the balancing figure. This is the balancing figure, and the balancing figure is 60,000. So this is the gift relief. So this is four mark calculation, and first I have identified the incorporation relief. And the second one is the gift relief. Now let's move to the other part. That is the Q Limited. Now this is the information about Q Limited. On 1st April 2022, I shall incorporate a new company, Q Limited. And this is the information. I have calculated Q Limited's budgeted tax adjusted loss for the year ended March 2023 is 44,000. So there is a loss of 44,000. When calculating the loss, I deducted the whole of the cost attributable to scientific research amounted to 1,02,000. There is a deduction already made of 1,02,000. I also deducted 1,000 in respect of the brand name, as it will be amortized over a period of 35. So there are two topics which we have to consider. One is R&D and other is brand. So this is a concept called corporation tax. Both the topics are examinable from corporations. Now, if you know the rule that what is the cost. Now, one important thing is that we need some information about the status of the company. We need to have some information about the status of the company. And it says that Q Limited will be a small enterprise for the purpose of additional tax relief available for expenditure on R&D. I have already established that the research to be carried out by Q Limited will qualify for the relief. I will not surrender any part of the loss in return for a cash refund from HM Revenue and Custom. So these are the additional information. So it's a small and medium enterprise, and we have to consider now small and medium enterprise. So now let's see. Equipment and computer hardware, 100% allowed. Full as a capital allowance. material, this is available against R&D. Rent is not available against R&D. Electricity and water, this is available against R&D. Staffing cost of 29,500. The rent is an appropriate allocation of the rent payable for the premise for the year. All of the staff costs relate to employees of Q Limited with the exception of 7,000 paid to an external contractor. Now, as far as external contractor is concerned, there is a restriction. If you are paying something to external contractor, then the amount is only eligible is uh, 65%. So 65% of the amount is eligible and 35% is not eligible. Now we have to identify how much tax deduction is available against R&D. First of all, I have to calculate the additional amount of availability. So let's identify. Let me just work it here. Total research cost is 1,02,000. Now, additional deduction. Let's identify the additional deduction. Now, from this 1,02,000, the additional deduction is material is allowed 21,000. Rent is not allowed. Staff cost is only allowed, which is 65%. And equipment is already allowed as 100%. So material is allowed, electricity is allowed 6,600, and staff cost is allowed. Staff cost excluding this external contractor, so it's 29,500 minus 7,000, so it's 22,500 is allowed. And the contractor is 7,000 multiplied by 65%. Now let's identify the value. So it's 21,000 plus 6,600 plus 22,500, 50100, and it's 4550. It's 21,000 plus 6,600 plus 22,500 plus 4550. It's 54650. This is the additional deduction amount, 54650. Now, we know the rule that for SME, 130% of this is allowed. So let's identify 1.30. So it's 7,105. So total amount that is available, we have already deducted. We have deducted the research cost of 102. but the additional allowed is this one. So total deduction allowed is 102 plus this. Total deduction is 173045. And how much we have deducted? We have just deducted 102000. So this is the R&D. This is the R&D part. So you have to explain again. You have to write some theory that how much is allowed, how much not allowed, and then you have to show some calculation regarding this part. So now let's move to another one. The next one is related to the brand information. This one, purchase of the brand. Another issue. On 1st April, Q Limited will purchase the brand name for 35,000. Advice will then be required on how to develop this brand through the use of social media. It is intended that this will purchase this advice from a company based outside the EU in a country where VAT is 9%. So this is related with VAT. So what exactly is the question? I also deducted 1,000 in respect of the brand as it is amortized over 35 years. So what was the cost? Cost was 35,000 and brand was amortized over 35 years. So 35,000 divided by 35. Now, as far as the brand is concerned, you can write one thing. Brand is right here. $1,000 amount is allowable. Just amount that is allowed is 1,000, which is 35,000. This is the normal treatment. Charged in profit and loss account as an expense. This is the allowable amount. But there is an allowed treatment, another amount, but another way is to get. Now there is another treatment is that you can get some different amount of allowance. And what was that? What is the different amount? Which is 4%. So I have to compare the value against the 4% value, that whether it's more than that or not. If my 4% value is more than that, then I have to choose which one is more beneficial. Whether 4% is more beneficial or the existing amount is more beneficial, and I have to choose the best one. So as far as the brand is concerned, let's identify 4% of 35,000. So you would 35,000 multiply by 4%, and this becomes 1,400. So an election is required to use this 1,400. So instead of 1,000, it is beneficial that you will get additional 400. Now, after this, the question says that identify the requirement was, this was the first requirement. We have completed this with respect to research and development. This is the second requirement. We have concluded this. Third requirement says that calculate the amended budgeted tax adjusted trading loss after considering the above two explanation. And explain how much of amended loss will be available for use by Porth Limited. So first of all, the amended loss, tax adjusted loss. So our existing tax adjusted loss was given as 44,000 budgeted loss was 44,000. Now additional research and development cost, additional allowed 71,045. This is additional 130%, and brand charges additional 400. That means revised loss 115,445. This is the third requirement. Now let's move to the fourth one. Fourth one says that explain how much of Q Limited's amended loss will be available for use by Porth Limited. Now for this we have to consider the structure. What is the structure? This is the structure, Q Limited. This is the structure of Q Limited. The ownership of Q Limited. So P Limited is having an ownership of 60%. So if any loss question is there, so we have to consider whether we can get the loss relief as is it at 75% loss relief group? So clearly not. So it means that we have to consider whether it's a consortium. Two things we have to consider in this part. Whether there is a 75% loss relief group. This is not possible here. Now, whether there is a consortium. So in order to a consortium, the percentage is in between 5 to 75%. So we have 60%. So it means that there's a possible consortium. So I will write some information about here that loss relief available. As there is no 75% loss relief group available. So we have to check whether it's a consortium company or not. In order to have consortium, now we have to write the condition. At least 5% but less than 75% holding is needed. So P Limited has 60% shares, so it's a consortium. What is the difference between 75% loss relief and consortium? So under consortium, the losses can be surrendered to Porth Limited up to the percentage. So we have losses can be shared as per percentage holding. And how much is the percentage holding? 60%. 115,445 multiply by 60%. So how much loss can be shared? 69,267 can be surrendered. So question was, let me check the question again. Explain how much of amended budgeted trading loss, even if your trading loss is wrong in point number three, still you will get the marks if your explanation is correct. So explain how much of amended budgeted trading loss will be available for use by Porth Limited. Now the next one is related to the VAT. And where is VAT information? There is VAT information in note number two. So we are looking for an advice. We have VAT registered. It is intended that Q Limited will purchase this advice from a company based outside EU in a country where rate of VAT is 9%. Now this is a case of overseas value added tax issue. And this is a case of services. So in case of services, if you know the rule that the client is based in UK, the company which is getting service is based in UK. So from the overseas service point of view, we have to consider the place of service where the client is present. So the place is UK. So instead of this 9% overseas rate, we will apply the UK rate of 20%. So this is a simple VAT calculation. So we have to write that. We have to write few points as per overseas VAT issue. The client is based in UK, so place of service is in UK. First point. So Q Limited will pay VAT at the rate of 20% rather than 9%. Ignore overseas rate. Under reverse charge procedure. First you will pay. What is reverse charge procedure? First you will pay output tax, then you will claim it as an input tax. So input tax can be claimed like normal. So the position is same as services being received from a UK company. So this is the brief explanation of the VAT services which Q Limited is getting from an overseas company. So these are the five parts. In B, there are five parts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And the marks are 15 marks. So for this part, which is a huge part, we have attempted the five parts. Separate marks are not mentioned in this question, but major marks are related with research and development. Now, acquisition of R Limited. What is the question exactly? Explain why the profits of R Limited are subject to UK tax. So it's a theory. Second, calculation. Calculate expected UK tax liability for the year ended March 23 based on information available. Third one, discuss the advantages and disadvantages of making an election to exempt the profit of its permanent establishment in Tirana from UK tax. So there are three parts of this one, and we will discuss one by one. First of all, let's discuss few information about R Limited. One of the problem with section 8 type questions, that is question number 1 worth 35 marks and the question number 2 worth 25 marks. The problem with that type of question is that you need to scroll the whole data. There is lots of information. So there is a likely chance that you miss some key information and you will just lose the marks. So on 1st May 2022, that is within the tax year 2022-23, Porth Limited will purchase the whole of the ordinary share capital of R Limited. For the purpose of UK tax, R Limited is resident in UK. And R Limited trades through a permanent establishment in the country of Tirana. Now, R Limited's budgeted taxable trading profit for the year ended March 23, all of which relates to its activity in Tirana. Now it's Tirana, which is an overseas country, is 75,000. R Limited has no other source of taxable income, is not expected to make any chargeable gain during the tax year. Once we are confident of the profitability of PE, permanent establishment in Tirana, it is intended that R Limited will establish permanent establishment in two other countries. So you have to focus on the rule of permanent establishment. Further information, R Limited has not made an election to exempt the profit of its overseas permanent establishment from UK tax. So it means if exemption has not been claimed, then the tax is to be paid in UK. The rate of tax in UK is 14% and double tax relief, DTR, tax credit, you have to consider the overseas tax credit of a corporation. Other than that, the tax system in Tirana is the same as in UK. There is no double tax treaty between the both countries. So unilateral tax relief, that is a tax credit method. We have to assess that. So what was the first question? The first question was, the first question says, explain why the profit of R Limited are subject to corporate tax in UK. Why R Limited is subject to corporate tax in UK? So let me write permanent establishment C part. Establishment number one. Why R Limited is subject to UK tax? So R Limited is subject to UK tax, you have to write down the rule. On profit of its permanent establishment in Tirana. Why? Because permanent establishment is not a separate legal entity. It's all about the rule. If you know the rule, marks are easy. One reason is that, and UK resident company is liable for worldwide income. If there is any UK resident company, the company has to pay tax on worldwide income in UK. Second one, question says that calculate tax liability. Calculate tax liability. So we have to consider the DTR as well in order to calculate the tax liability. So let's find out the tax liability. So we have, first of all, UK tax. So we have to see how much income was available. So income was 75,000. So what is the tax rate in UK? The UK tax rate is 19%. 14250. Now, as they have already paid tax in overseas, so the tax credit is lower of UK tax and overseas tax paid. What is the overseas? Overseas at the rate of 14%, it's clearly lower off. So just deduct that lower off 10,500. And the UK tax liability is 3750. So an easy part, the basic calculation. Third one. And what was the third one? The third one was, discuss the advantages and disadvantages of making an election to exempt the profits of his permanent establishment. This is again a simple theory, that what are the advantages and disadvantages of making an election? So the advantage is that no tax is to be paid in UK. So if no tax is to be paid in UK, so we are paying, as a result, there is a saving of 75,000 multiplied by higher rate minus lower rate. So there is a saving of 5%. This is the advantage. But if you opt for exemption, then the problem is that there will be no relief of loss in UK against that permanent establishment. That means if permanent establishment in Tirana has any loss, that you will not get any loss relief. This election is irrevocable. What it means? It means that it is applicable on all future permanent establishment. So you have to see, it was written in the question that you are planning to have permanent establishment in other countries as well. So there will be no loss relief available in UK against overseas companies. So this is the three-part answer or last part C. Now overall, there are lots of issues being asked in this exam, a question, CGT, research and development, branding, and somewhat permanent establishment, and some sort of consortium as well, advantages and disadvantages of permanent establishment exemption. So now again, first of all, let's identify what are the issues that being asked in the question. So Thomas requires advice on the tax implication of commencement to trade. So tax implication of commencement to trade. One issue. Issue number one. The choice of accounting date. Very important topic. Basis period, change of accounting date, choice of accounting date. Number two. Whether or not to register voluntarily for value-added tax purpose. Three. VAT part question. And his wife requires advice on the tax implication of selling shares with CGT and relief under enterprise investment scheme, part number four. So in a single question, there is some income tax issues, some VAT issues, and some CGT relief issues. The first question that we have discussed was related with some income tax issues. Now let's see what is the requirement. So requirement number one says that on the assumption that Thomas prepared his first set of accounts to 31st March 2022, explain with some calculations the difference in total amount of tax payable by him as a result of profit on the sale of sporting memorabilia being treated as trading income rather than chargeable. So it's about whether we are classifying a business activity as a trading activity or a chargeable gain. So you have to calculate on the assumption that it's a trading income, the difference that how much is the tax liability difference. In the next part, identify basis period for the tax year 22-23. If he adopts a year end date of 31st March or 30th April and state two advantages of adopting 30th April as his year end date. 5 marks. This is basis period calculation. Explain two matters which Thomas should consider in deciding whether or not it will be financially viable to voluntarily register for VAT. A small one, 3 marks. And explain the tax implication of her intended sale of shares on 1st June and calculate after tax sale proceed. 7 marks. This is EIS relief. Now let's discuss the information. First one, who is Thomas? What is the tax status of Thomas? Thomas is UK resident as well as UK domicile. Now I noted down one important thing that the residence status, the domicile status, the deemed domicile, all are important issues in any exam. Should know how to identify someone as a tax resident, as a domicile, what is the deemed domicile. So you should keep in mind all these rules. use his capital gain tax annual exemption each year. Already used, so that means annual exemption is not available. Receive dividend of 2000 every year. Now, important thing is that this is to be covered against NRB. We know that NRB against dividend is 2000 irrespective of the type of income. Now, Thomas sale of sporting memorabilia. Thomas started selling items of this sports from his collection during the tax year 2021. HM Revenue and Custom agreed that these should be subject to CGT in the tax year 2021. In April 21, that is 2022, Thomas started purchasing and selling more items of sporting memorabilia, such as HMRC have said that he will be regarded as a trading with effect from 6th April 2021. Now is considered to be a sole trader business. Thomas will not be required to register for VAT for the foreseeable future. Thomas will, however, consider registering voluntarily if it is beneficial for him to do so. So what is the result? Thomas results. Thomas is considering either a 31st March date or 30th April. Thomas estimates that his total income less expenditure for the 12 month ending 31st March 2022 will be 11,500. Each item is purchased and sold for no more than 1,000. What it means? It means there is a CGT criteria of 6,000 rule. Should remember the rule of 6,000. All of the cost he incurs are deductible for tax purpose. Thomas expects his profit to increase after 1st April. This is the indicator for identifying the correct date. Now, on the basis of this information, we have to solve the first part. On the assumption that Thomas prepared his first set of accounts to 31st March 2022. So, tax treatment A. Now, if I'll assume that this is considered as trading income, so my trading income is 11,500. So trading income is 11,500. The personal allowance 12,500. So my trading income becomes zero. What about my dividend income? My dividend income is 2000 and this is subject to 2000 NRB. Again, it's zero. Even if my personal allowance is available, then it will offset some of my dividend income and the rest is to be covered under NRB. So no need to do some excess calculation. It's enough. So there is no income tax liability. Income tax, taxable income is zero. So we have taxable income, zero, no income tax. But we have to calculate the difference in tax. So an individual who is a sole trader has to pay national insurance contribution. And what type of national insurance contribution an individual has to pay? NIC2 and NIC4. NIC2, you have to see in the tax sheet, it's fixed 3.05. So class 2, it's 3.05 multiplied by 52. The rates are given in the sheet. So it's 159. What about class 4? Is a threshold based class 4. It's a percentage based, which is 9%. The basic is 9% more than if it is more than 9,500. So our profit is 11,500. Limit is 9,500 multiply by 9%. So we have 180 of NIC. So my total NIC liability is 339. This is assuming I am considering my business as a sole trader. Now what about capital gain tax? I have to compare it with the capital gain tax, if any. So now, as far as capital gain is considered, so sports memorabilia is a chattel having value less than 6,000. So it's exempt. There is no CGT because it's exempt. So difference in tax is 0 versus 339. So additional tax I have to pay while considering this business as a sole trader as 339. So this is an easy part. It was considered to be a difficult one initially, but it's an easy one. Now let's move on to the second part, which is the theory one. Identify Thomas basis period for the tax year 22-23. If he adopts a year end date of 31st March and either or 30th April, and then advantages. So we have to identify the basis period first. So next part is basis period. And first is considering 31st March. If we consider this as a 12-month year end, and what is the basis period? 22-23. So the period is 12 months to 31st March 2023, making it 22-23. This is the basis period because it's a starting period. And if it's April, so if the year end is April, so when the business is started, what is the starting date? 1st April 2021. So then my year end would be, it's 30th April 2022. So as a result, the period is 12 months to 30th April 2022. And this will result in 22-23. These are the basis period. Now, what is the advantage of making a 30th April year end? Two advantages. So if I make 30th April year end, let me just identify the exact date. 30th April year end. So advantages are, number one of the advantages is that it will maximize the interval between earning profit. It will maximize the interval between earning profit and paying tax. Why? Because if the year end is 31st March 2023, So income tax liability will be due on 31st January 2024. Now another advantage. The profit is known earlier. As a result, more time is available for planning. Because if we opt for 31st March rather, so we have more time to make some planning, to get some benefits, to some reduce the tax liability. So two advantages were being asked. You can write any two advantage. So I've just identified these two advantages. Next is explain two matters which Thomas should consider in deciding whether or not it will be financially viable. Now there are two types of registration of VAT. One is the compulsory registration and other is the voluntarily registration. Now, as far as the compulsory registration is concerned, you should know the rule that historical test and the future test, it will be satisfied. Now, in order to adopt the voluntary registration, first of all, you have to see that what is the status of his customer. If we can make a heading, first point is a status of customer. Who is your customer? If the customer is a registered business, a B2B, so in that case, if the customer can reclaim input tax, and reclaim input tax. But if customer is non-registered, VAT will be an additional cost for him, making our business less competitive, because now we are selling expensive goods. So this is the first point. You should see who is your customer. If your customer is a non-business customer, then do not need to register as a voluntary VAT registration. Wait for the threshold. Types of supply. Another factor is type of supply. What type of supply you are selling? If your supply is zero rated, it means no output, but a registered business can claim input tax. So it means if you want to register voluntarily, you can get your input tax back earlier. So don't need to wait for the threshold. Just get this status and get the benefit. 2 points are enough, because specifically 2 points were being asked, two matters which we have to consider. So as an examination point of view, if you see the second part B is already repetitive. It's in revision kit in the past paper. So many times examiner has asked this basis period calculation, the advantages of different basis period date, March and April, and the VAT. This is again being asked again. Previous past paper contains this type of question, voluntary registration. So A, B, C, not that much difficult in terms of examination. Now the last one. Now, as far as the last one is concerned, let's see the information. His wife is UK resident in domicile, higher rate taxpayer, will make no disposal for CGT purpose other than this one, sale of painting. She sold a painting on 4th July for proceed of 1,96,000. The sale gave rise to a gain of 86,000. Acquisition of shares in Tavira Limited, subscribed 72,000 worth shares. These are qualifying EIS scheme. Elected to defer the maximal possible amount of gain on the sale of painting against the acquisition of shares. Obtained EIS relief against her income tax liability in the previous year. In the 1920, she intends to sell all of the shares for 95,000 on June 2022. If undertaken, this sale would qualify for BADR. So BADR is available. It has been mentioned in the question that this is eligible for BADR. Now, what is the question? Explain the tax implication of her intended sale of shares on 1st June 2022. This is a very good question of CGT. So first of all, we have to see that what is the tax consequences? We have to see that what is the ownership period. So when we have purchased these shares, we have purchased these shares on 8th October 2019. And if we plan to sell these on 1st June 2022, we have to count how many years have been passed. So from 2019, 2020, 1 year, 2021, 2 year, 2022. So the shares are being sold or planning to be sold within 3 years. So what are the consequences? If shares are being sold within 3 years, then it means that whatever EIS you have obtained, you have to pay back. These will be withdrawn. So you have to just see the rule of EIS, that there is a withdrawn of EIS if you have getting the benefit. Okay, so first of all, we have to identify the gain on sale of shares. Gain of sale of shares. So the sale proceed, which we are selling this at a price of 95,000. The cost of the original shares was 72,000. So there is a gain. And the gain is 23,000. So as the shares are or will be sold before 3 years, So whatever EIS has been claimed will be withdrawn. Now, as a result, you have to see how much EIS has been claimed in the previous years. So EIS relief against income tax liability, 18,600. So you have to withdraw that 18,600 plus. As a result of purchasing this proceed, selling, you have used this proceed of 1,96,000. Gain was 86,000. So you have used this to purchase EIS. So that means the gain was deferred against the EIS shares. Now, as a result of violation of this 3 years rules, so the gain on painting, which was deferred, is taxable now. Now there are two types of gain. One is the gain on sale of shares, and another thing is gain on the disposal of painting. This gain is restricted to 72,000, which is the cost of shares. Now, one gain is eligible for BADR, the other gain is not eligible for BADR. So we have to work out gain eligible for business relief, gain not eligible. So shares, the gain eligible for BADR, 23,000, painting, 72,000, not eligible. Total 23,000 and 72,000. Now, as far as the annual exemption is concerned, so we'll see whether there's an annual exemption or not. So we have to use this annual exemption. Now, the best possible way of annual exemption is to use again the non-BADR rule. So as a result, our taxable gain is 23,000. And here our taxable gain is 59,700. Now we have to apply tax, CGT. So first of all, you have to apply BADR. 23,000. What is the rate of BADR? 10%. And it's against, as it's a higher rate taxpayer, so this is subject to 20%. And this 20% is, what is the total? So this is CGT. We have total 18,600. Is $16,300. Now after say tax proceed, so income tax we have to pay it again. What was the EIS relief income tax liability? And that was 18,000. This is 14,240. This is wrong calculation. So let me just do the calculation. This is income tax liability 18,600, while CGT is different. CGT is 2,359,700 into 0.2. It's 11,940 plus 2,300. It's 14,240. So total tax liability is 14,240 plus 18,600. So what is the after tax sale proceed? The shares are sold at 95,000. 95,000 is the sale proceed. Income tax withdrawn, relief withdrawn is 18,600, and CGT is 14,240. So what would be the proceed after tax proceed? It's 95,000 minus 18,600 minus 14,240. So it's 62,160. Let me check the requirement again. Requirement was says that explain the tax implications. So you have to write the theory about whatever we have discussed, and then calculate the after tax sale proceed. And this is the calculation part. From here, this is the calculation part. This is the complete calculation. And before that, we'll write the theory about this. So this is the complete question.